Good morning, everyone. This is Swati, and I'm going to take the webinar today for the assessor's update on the awards questionnaire and assessment. So the purpose of today's webinar is that all of you have gone through the assessor's training either this year or in last 1 or 2 years. So we are going to give a brief description about the awards, the assessment process. The main focus will be on the online assessment, any new features that we have introduced this year. And the idea is also to refresh you on the online tool. And this will be followed by the question and answer session. So we'll take 45 minutes to take you through the assessment and the online questionnaire. And after that, we will spend next 30 to 40 minutes in taking up your questions. Anytime you have a question while you're going through the webinar, you can type it in the panel, which is meant for question, which appears at the on the right-hand side of the webinar panel that you can view on your screen. And we will take up the list of questions only towards the end of the webinar. So just to remind you, the award categories basically has two categories. The first one is the corporate excellence, and the second one is domain excellence. Domain excellence in itself has three sub-award categories. The first one is environment management, then corporate social responsibility, and then biodiversity. Each of these categories, the company can apply in each of these categories. They can also apply for both the categories, and they can also apply for multiple categories in the domain excellence. The difference between corporate excellence and domain excellence is that when a company applies for corporate excellence, the assessment of the entire organization takes place. So you look at integration of sustainability across the organization, starting from the governance structure, going up till their supply chain, looking at their biodiversity impact, and looking at their entire, all the functions within the organization. The difference in domain excellence is that the assessment remains limited only to the domain in which the company has applied for and the relevant functions which are associated with the domain in which the company has applied. So for example, if a company has applied for environment management, only the environment performance will be assessed and the relevant functions related to environment management will become part of the assessment. There are different levels of recognition under corporate excellence and under domain excellence. Companies can win a recognition across these recognition categories. Corporate excellence, the top recognition is Business of the Year. This is given only to one company in a year. This is followed by Outstanding Accomplishment, which is followed by Significant Achievement. Under both Outstanding Accomplishment and Significant Achievement, there can be multiple winners across various turnover classifications. So as you may remember, there are turnover classifications starting from A and going up till E. Additionally, there is a turnover classification specifically for units. So the winners can come from each of these turnover classification across the two categories which are mentioned under corporate excellence. So there can be multiple winners under outstanding accomplishment and under significant achievement. Similarly, in domain excellence, the two recognition are excellence in domain, which is the topmost recognition, followed by significant achievement. Here again, there can be multiple winners, again, depending on the turnover classification in which the company has applied. So there can be multiple winners in excellence in domain and multiple winners in significant achievement as well. Now, what is new for the awards this year? Just to give you a heads up, The CII ITC Sustainability Awards are third-party assured. We got third-party assurance from DNVGL. You may be aware of this assurance agency. We got assured in 2016. In 2017, we are aspiring to become carbon neutral. So all the relevant activities on awards, including the jury meetings, the assessors assessment, including desk and site assessment, any travels that are done for assessors training and the ceremony, all of it will get included in making awards carbon neutral. And some of you who were part of the assessors training this year have already given the details of your travel. All the assessors, when they are going to take up the site assessments, your travel from your location to the applicant location will also be tracked in terms of the emissions, and that will become part of making the awards carbon neutral. The second update is on the numbers that we have received this year. So the total application of intent that we have received this year is 106. That's the updated number till today. In corporate excellence, we have around 26 applications. In environment management, 36, corporate social responsibility, 41, biodiversity, 5. We have trained 66 new assessors this year, and out of the total assessor pool that we have till date, 120 assessors are participating in assessment this year. So I thank all of you for not just registering for the webinar, but also taking part in the assessment. This is again to give you a broad idea about the award cycle. So we are now proceeding to the desk assessment stage. The application stage is over, which is mainly meant for applicants, where the applicants have to register and then start filling up their applications. The deadline for us to receive the filled up questionnaire is 16th June. After that, we will take some time to do the preliminary screening before we pass on the applications to you. In the same time, we are going to also start composing the teams. The process is underway. So by end of June, you will receive an intimation from our end in terms of your registration on the tool for all the new assessors. And for all the old assessors, you will get to know which teams you are belonging to and what is your team composition. So the desk assessment is mainly going to start from mid or end of June and will go up till end of July. I think end of July is the last date to submit the desk assessment. This again, here the desk assessment will take place in two parts, the individual desk assessment and consensus desk assessment. We leave it to the teams to decide how they want to time themselves in terms of individual and consensus desk assessment. Most of the desk assessment is facilitated by the team lead. However, the consensus call facilitation is done by the awards team. So you will receive the conference call facilities and each team will receive that. The team lead is expected to circulate the details of the conference call among the team members, and you can utilize these conference call details to conduct your consensus call through conference call facility. We will start with the site assessment from September. So end of July, when you're going to complete your desk assessment, we will take a week and 10 days to analyze everything, and the same will be presented to the jury in mid of August. And it is during this time that the jury is going to decide which are the applicants going forward with the site assessment. We will start communicating you the results of site assessment by end of August. and we will also communicate the same to the applicants who have qualified for site assessment. We are expecting the site assessments to start from September, and we're giving 2 months to site assessments. So September and October will be the 2 months when site assessments are going to take place. Here again, the objective will be that assessors are going to visit the companies, visit their corporate offices, and in case if it's a manufacturing company, visit their factories and manufacturing locations. Look for evidence and any information gaps that they have found in the application submitted, and seek the relevant information and finalize the consensus assessment for applicants. Again, all your consensus site assessment will be submitted while you are on site on the last day of your site visit schedule. And from there, once the site assessment has been completed, again, the awards team is going to take a week or 10 days to analyze the result and to present it to the jury. The last jury meeting for the year is scheduled in mid of November. And it is during this time that the jury is going to decide the winners of the awards for this year. We are going to communicate the results to applicants during this time in end of November. Also, we will utilize the month of November to do assessor recognition survey. So all the assessors who are going to participate in assessment, both desk and site, are going to rate and do a survey of their peer assessors. So assessor recognition survey will be based on that, and the winners of assessor recognition survey will also be announced in the award ceremony, which is scheduled on 12th of December. So 12th of December will be the ceremony where we are going to felicitate the winner companies as well as the winner assessors for awards 2017. After this, as part of the closure of the cycle, we are going to complete the feedback report of the companies. One cycle of feedback report will be completed immediately after desk assessment. So all the companies which are not qualifying for site assessment, their feedback report basis the assessment that you have done as teams will be given to them in September and October. And the companies which qualify for site assessment, their feedback report basis the site assessment done by all of you will be given to them by end of December. This will also give companies sufficient time to look at the assessment done for their companies, look at the recommendations if there are any, and to take required steps and prepare themselves for next year's award cycle, where again they will have to register in the month of March and start filling up the questionnaire from April onwards. Very briefly, I'm going to take you through the assessment methodology. So you are already familiar with the Sustainable Business Excellence Framework that is followed to do the sustainability performance assessment of companies which apply for awards. Here again, this framework is adapted from EFQM, which is European Foundation for Quality Management Framework, which is a business excellence framework. So we follow an enablers and results approach where we look at the performance of the company across enablers, which is the processes and how the company is driving to achieve results. And under results, what are the results the company has achieved? Under both enablers and result, we are mainly looking at the sustainability performance. So for example, in leadership, the idea is to understand how is the leadership driving the organization to become a sustainable business? What are the key goals and key targets the leadership has set for the organization to achieve, and how is the leadership driving the organization through systems, processes, and governance structure. Then what are the engagement mechanisms the organization has to engage with its internal as well as external stakeholders? These will include training programs, capability building programs, various other mechanisms that the companies adopt to engage with its prioritized stakeholders. There are indicators which also look at mobilization of key resources. So how is the organization mobilizing its financial resources, its infrastructural resources, its human resources, and various other resources which it may need to mobilize in order to achieve the sustainability goals and targets that it has set for itself. Under results, we look at the financial results as well as environmental and social results. Both environment and social results look at internal as well as the external results. So for example, the environment impacts that the organization may have through its transportation are also looked at. Supply chain numbers and impacts are also looked at under results. The last pillar of the Sustainable Business Excellence Framework, which is learning and review, mainly looks at how, after achieving the result, the organization is utilizing the learnings and embedding the learnings in the process back. Learning and review is an ongoing process for the companies. So it is not necessary that learning and review takes place only after the results are achieved. It is an ongoing process, and the company can keep deriving learnings from its processes also and keep improvising and making its processes better. So a lot of aspects, you will see that there are learning and review relevant indicators which mainly look at how the outputs are used to improvise and make improvements in the existing work that the organization has. So when we are looking at these key seven attributes of the Sustainable Business Excellence Framework, which is leadership, processes, key resources, stakeholder engagement internal, stakeholder engagement external, results, learning and innovation, these seven attributes are looked at across the various aspects that we have. So the 15 aspects that are looked for the sustainability performance assessment of a corporate excellence application, each of these seven attributes that we discussed in the previous slide are mapped in each of these 15 aspects. As you can see, these 15 aspects are relevant for a corporate excellence application, be it for a company or for a unit. The relevant aspects like corporate social responsibility will become applicable for a company if it applies for corporate social responsibility domain. Similarly, product responsibility and environment management will be applicable to companies which apply for environment management domain. And biodiversity aspect will become applicable for companies which apply for biodiversity domain. Compliance to regulation is one aspect which is more like a context building aspect. It is not scored. So only aspects which are coded from F1 to F14 are scored basis the assessment that you are going to do. Compliance to regulation is a laundry list of regulations which are applicable to companies depending on the sector and nature of their business. This is just to provide you an idea of what are the relevant regulations which are applicable to companies. Compliance to regulation again is a common aspect which run across all the award categories. However, compliance to regulation is divided into four subsets. There are economic regulations list, there is an environment regulation list, there is a social regulation list, and then there is a biodiversity regulation list. When you're looking at a corporate excellence application, all the four lists will appear in the application. Whereas when you're looking at a domain-specific application, only the regulations which are specific to that domain will appear. So for example, in corporate social responsibility, only relevant social laws and regulations will appear. Similarly, in biodiversity, only biodiversity-specific laws and rules will appear. So you as assessor have to go and look at this, the list which the company has checked, and basis your understanding, just try and find out if the relevant regulations which are there have been ticked by the company or not. This also requires discussion within the team. So every team member brings in different expertise. So depending on the diversity of the team can look at the compliance to regulation section together and look at any of the regulations which the company has not tick marked and keep it aside for the site visit. From here, we will move on to the online assessment. Now, all our assessors who are old assessors, meaning all of you who got trained with us till last year, your registration has already taken place last year. So you had already received an email which is an automatic email last year indicating your username and your password. Most of you, I remember, had gone and changed the password to make it more friendly in terms of remembering it. All the assessors who have been trained with us, their registration will start on the tool in next few days. All the assessors who got trained with us and have submitted to us the signed letters, their registration will start immediately. If there are any assessors who have taken the training but have not sent their signed service arrangements, their registration will not take place until unless we receive their signed agreement. There is also a deadline to the signed agreement, so in order for you to take up the assessment, you will have to submit your service arrangement in next 1 week. So when an assessor gets registered on the tool, there is an automatic email which gets triggered, and you will receive it in the email ID that you have shared with us. That registration email will indicate your username. Again, the username will be the email ID that you have shared with us, and a password, which is a complicated password but automatically generated by the tool. In case if you want to make a change in the email ID on which you want to take up the assessment, now is the time that you can inform us, because once that email ID has been configured, it will become a little complicated for us to go and change it. All your communication from the tool regarding the assessment will be directed to this email ID. Just below the password, there will be a link which can take you directly to the online interface. So by clicking on that link, you can go and look at the interface. It will look like this. The login page basically asks for your username and the password. Anytime during the assessment process, if you have forgotten your password, you can click on the forgot password link. An automatic password will be generated and will be sent to you. Also, for all the old assessors, you may not remember even the passwords which you had changed last year. All you have to do is just to click on the forgot password. The message will ask you to type in your email ID, and the password will be directed to that email ID. Once you have logged in to the tool, it will take you to the assessor dashboard. Now, just to give you a heads up on what the assessor dashboard looks like, so on the extreme right corner of the assessor dashboard, you will see your name flashing. Just below that, it will also give you the option to change your password. We suggest that when you make the first login, you go and change the password and make a password which is easier for you to remember, because you're going to use the assessor dashboard for the next 3-4 months. When we come down below, we see a table, and here, as you can see, in the table, the leftmost column, which says applicant, will give you the details of the applications which are allocated to you. There can be 2 or maximum 3 applications which can be allocated to a team. Besides applicant, there is a turnover classification mentioned. So by looking at it, you can understand the size of the company which has been allocated to you. Turnover classification A is the biggest application, and this year we have also changed the turnover classification. So A is for those companies which are more than 10,000 crores. After turnover classification, the award category is mentioned, giving you an indication that under which award category the applicant has applied for. Beside that, there is a submission date, which basically indicates that when was the application submitted by the company. Then we come to the current status column. By default, the current status will be desk assessment team assigned. The moment you start doing your assessment on the tool, the status will change to desk assessment in progress. This will further change to desk assessment completed as you move forward in doing the assessment. Process status is just a graphical representation of what the current status mentions. The main work lies under the action items. So right now on the screen, you can see that there are 3 action items listed. These action items increases as you move to the next stage of assessment. So let's go through each of these action items in detail. The first action item, which is team composition, by clicking on this, you will see who all are there in your team. mostly a team composition comprised of 4 to 5 members. This is mainly for companies which are big and have applied for corporate excellence application. For domain excellence application, we can have a 3 to 4 member team as well. An assessment cannot take place with less than 3 team members. So every time you will receive a team, there will be a minimum of 3 team members. If at any stage there are any dropouts, we will add a new member to the team as and when required. Other than looking at the team composition, the table also gives the details of who's the team lead in your team. Beside the team composition, there is also a facility which can take you to your peer members assessment. So this can only be visible when you have completed your assessment as well as your peer member has completed the assessment. This facility is to enable and facilitate the consensus discussions that you're going to have during desk assessment. So before you get into the desk assessment, it is required that each team member within a team completes their individual assessment. A consensus desk assessment cannot take place until unless all the team members have completed their desk assessment. The second thing is that before you get into a consensus call and a consensus meeting, please go through each and every member's desk assessment. Mark out the areas where there are disagreements or conflicts and take up those areas mainly as the key points of discussion in your consensus calls. So your majority of time should go in discussing points where there is disagreement. Also discuss points where there is an agreement to close the issues. So the facility will help you go through each and every member's desk assessment and to prepare you for your consensus calls. The second action item is the application document. When you click on this bulleted action item, it will open into a new page and it will take you to the submitted questionnaire that the applicant has submitted. This will open into an application document, and this is also the place where you're going to do all your work in terms of assessment. We will go through the application document a little more in detail after I have covered all the action items. After the application document, there are 3 more action items which will appear. By default, the first action item, which is symboled with P, will appear for all the teams. This action item basically means that the preliminary report is available to you for your assessment. Preliminary report is nothing but a submitted application document sorted with strengths, opportunities, information gaps, and descriptive questions. You may remember it from the assessor's training that which you were part of. The case study that you have worked upon was the preliminary report of the company that had applied last year or last to last year. It's a submitted application. The only difference is that all the objective questions get scored, and basis the score that is given to these objective questions, they are identified either as strengths, opportunities, information gaps, or descriptive questions. After the individual has done the desk assessment, and after you have done your consensus meeting and the team lead has submitted the consensus desk assessment, another report will get generated, which is the desk assessment report. The desk assessment report is an advanced report of preliminary report. All the questions which were identified as descriptive questions under the preliminary report also get marked basis the validation that you choose as a team, and basis that a score is allocated to these questions which further identifies them as either strengths or opportunities or information gaps. Finally, there will be a site assessment report for all the companies which qualify for site assessment. After desk assessment, the companies which qualify, you have to make a visit to them, and basis the site visit and the evidence gathered, you're going to revise your consensus assessment and submit it on the tool. Basis that assessment, a site assessment report will get generated. And this will again appear as the third report under the action item. Here the important point that I would like to remind is that when an individual has completed their desk assessment, their assessment will be freezed and you cannot go and make any change. All the consensus desk assessment will be submitted by the team lead. So during your consensus meeting and consensus call as a team, once you have decided that what are the disagreements and what are you agreeing to, basis that the team lead sheet will open into an edit mode, and in that sheet the team lead can make the relevant changes to the validations as well as to the assessor's view. Both of these are important for the team to look at as part of assessments. Also during desk assessment, you will be given a feature of marking the question for site visit, which was not there till last year. So against each question, there will be a functionality where you can mark the question for site assessment and provide a reason why you're marking that question for site assessment. All your reason and the questions which are marked for site assessment will start appearing separately in the desk assessment report. This is again to facilitate your work during site assessment. Till last year, you were noting down all your site assessment queries in a separate document. Now your desk assessment document will become one stop for everything in terms of listing the questions as strengths, opportunities, information gaps, as well as identifying questions which are marked for site visit and the reason or the questions which you need to ask the company while you're on site visit. So please utilize the feature that has been introduced this year to the fullest, and the idea is to facilitate your work during the site assessment. Again, while you're on site assessment, individuals cannot do any change to their individual assessment. When a company qualifies for site assessment, again the same desk assessment that was submitted by the team lead will open into edit mode, and the team lead can go and make the changes. However, the team lead is required to have a consensus meeting while on site and only make those edit changes which have been agreed by the team together. During site assessment, the entire application document is available in the edit mode, which means that even the questions which the company has submitted in their questionnaire, they can be changed by you. So in case if there are any conflicts that you find during site assessment, or if there is any additional information or less information that you find during site assessment, you can very well go and make those changes in the answers provided by the company, both for objective as well as descriptive questions. Basis the submission that the team lead is going to do on the site assessment sheet, that will get submitted as a site assessment consensus for the team. Here again, we would like to remind that please make sure that you revise your assessor's view during site assessment, because all the assessor's view which you're going to submit as part of your site assessment will be taken as final. Again, once the submission has been made, no change can be made further in the submission and the assessment that the team has submitted. From here, we now move to the online application. So if you remember, the second action item, which is a bulleted action item, if you click on that, you will be taken to the online application, which will open into a new page. The landing page for you will be the instructions page. The instructions page basically has some very general guiding points for your reference. It will also have an upload of some of the documents which you require for your reference during assessment. So for example, the awards questionnaire template will be available to you in the first bullet point. If you want to refer to the awards questionnaire template in PDF form, you can click on the link and you can download the PDF of the awards questionnaire. Similarly, the guidance document on the entire questionnaire is also available for your reference. The guidance document briefly talks about the assessment methodology, the question description, abbreviations, scoring methodology, and there is a guidance on each and every indicator which is part of the assessment. So anytime you want to refer to the guidance on any question where you need a little heads up or any reference, you can always go to the guidance document which is provided on the instructions page. There are other relevant guiding points, so we insist that you go through these instructions before you start attempting your assessment. Some of the important points here are with reference to the assessment that you're going to do. So all the questions which are validation based, where you have to mark a validation, will be marked in an arrow button. When you click on the arrow button, the list of validation will open. Basis the choice that you make, you can make a selection on the list of validation. Just below the list of validation, there will be a validate button, which is also a save button for the selection that you have made. Once you validate, your selection will be saved and you can proceed with your assessment. Assessor views are mandatory for each and every aspect which will be part of the questionnaire or the award category in which the company has applied. So no assessor view can be left blank. The important point for you is that please refer to the additional information provided by the company. You can refer it through the additional information box which will appear below the aspect. You can also refer to the additional information which will automatically appear in the preliminary report. There is a lot of context building information that companies provide in the additional information. Companies are also instructed to provide additional information giving the reference to the questions against which they are providing the information. So we request that before you assess the aspect or the application, go through the additional information. Session timeout here again is 30 minutes. So as you may remember, the tool is not equipped to do an auto save. So while you are on the tool and you are making any assessment, please make sure that you save your work before the clock is out of 30 minutes. If there is any work which is not saved, it will be lost and it cannot be retrieved from the backend. Every time you make a save or hit on a save button, the clock automatically revises to 30 minutes. You can do part of your assessment and you can come back to the assessment later also. So the clock doesn't mean that you have to complete your assessment within 30 minutes. Here again, the tip is that before you start doing the assessment, please go through the application once from beginning to end. So you download the preliminary report, which is available on your dashboard. Take a hard copy if you are comfortable with that. Go through the preliminary report of the company. Go through the management description section where the company is going to provide the relevant sustainability challenges and risks that they are facing as the nature of the business and what are the key strategies that they have adopted or planning to adopt to take care of these challenges and risks. Plus, also prepare yourself for the company in the sense, understand the nature of business, understand the sector dynamics by looking at some of the secondary information available about the company. So the best idea is to go through the company's website if you're not relevant with the sector. Also have an orientation call within the team. Ideally, the team lead should facilitate that, but any team member can also proactively suggest this. So before you start your assessment, have like a half an hour or 1 hour call where the team can talk about the company, any information that you may know. This also gives an opportunity to those assessors who may not be belonging to the same sector to understand what are the key sector dynamics that they should be aware of while dealing with an application of that kind. So the left panel of the application document basically deals with various sections. As you can see on the screen, after instructions, we have section A, which is the applicant registration information. This basically is a one-pager giving details of the relevant details about the company, in the sense the relevant person who is responsible for the application, the senior most person. Here usually the CEO or the CSO name is mentioned and the relevant contact for sustainability awards. This information will be used by you and the awards team during site assessment. Before site assessment, you are not required to get in touch with the company by looking at the details mentioned in Section A. Section B is a statement of authenticity where you would know that who in the company has provided the approval on the information that the applicant has provided in the form. Section C is a general information section giving you details on the kind of company, whether it's a public limited company or a private limited company, the shareholding pattern of the company, then the product portfolio. So the top five products, their revenue, their market share will be mentioned. The vision, mission, policies will be asked in Section C. So Section C is more of a context building section. Please go through this section in detail and don't miss out on any information. This section will also have information on employee turnover, employee details. So the workforce that the company has. Again, the information asked here is on the top management, the middle level management, the diversity in terms of gender diversity, the number of contract workers, and so on. Section D is a management description section. As I had mentioned earlier, this basically is not just a summary of what the company has written in Section F, but further to that, applicants are expected to write mainly what is written in the management discussion of the annual report. So here you will find information mainly what the key business of the company is. Other than that, the key focus areas here are that what are the key sustainability challenges, risks that the company is facing, and how is the company dealing or going to deal with these risks. This also gives you a lot of context which you can build before you start attempting Section F, where the main information that the company has provided is on sustainability and how they are dealing with sustainability. Section E is a tabular section where the company provides mainly the abbreviations, if at all they have used, across Section F, and the full form against those abbreviations. Section A to Section E are more context building. They are not to be scored, so you're not required to do any action from Section A to Section E. This is mainly meant for you to read and understand the nature of business, the kind of company, when it started, the shareholding pattern, the key products, the kind of competitors that the company has. Your action basically lies in Section F, where the list of questions will be part of Section F. Now, depending on the award category in which the company has applied, the left panel under Section F will give the details of the aspect which are applicable to the company. In case if it's a corporate excellence application, you will see 15 aspects appearing under Section F. In case if it's any of the domain excellence application, only the relevant aspect which are relevant for that domain will appear. Here on the screen, this screenshot is from a corporate social responsibility application. So as you can see, under Section F, there are only two aspects which are appearing. One is corporate social responsibility and the other one is compliance to regulation. Under Section F, all the questions are mandatory to be assessed. No question can be left blank. Your action may lie only for questions which are subjective in nature, but all the objective questions also have to be taken in consideration while you're assessing the aspect. So objective question has information about the company. You have to go through that information. Descriptive question has information. You not only have to go through those questions, but also mark the relevant validation against the descriptive questions. That is your first action. The second will be to write the assessor view on the entire aspect. When you're writing the assessor's view, it is for the entire aspect and not for specific questions. So that is why it is important that you go through the objective questions and descriptive questions together. Again, your assessor's view can be structured the way you want to structure them, but please make sure that your assessor view are for an aspect and not specifically for questions. you can identify key strengths and key opportunities and mention them separately, or you can build them together and have different paragraphs mentioning about interlinkages between strengths and opportunities. We leave it to the individual and to the teams to decide how they want to structure their assessor's view. As I said, every descriptive question will have the list of validation. So if you click on any of the descriptive question, there is an arrow button against the descriptive question number. When you click on that arrow button, the list of validation will appear. You will be required to mark or make a selection from the list that is provided. Until unless you make a selection, you will not be allowed to proceed in assessment. You can also choose not to make a selection by just closing the box and not hitting on the validate button. The moment you click on the validate button, the selection that you have made will be saved. However, you can come back and change the selection that you have made before you finally submit the assessment. So before you make a submission, you can make changes to your validation or to your assessor's view as many times as you want to. There will be different trend questions in the application. Trend questions mainly are result-oriented questions. They ask from the company the five-year performance and what the company has budgeted for the next 5 years. Every trend question is validation-based. So against each of the trend questions, there will be a set of validations provided to you. Depending on how you read the trends, you can mark the selection. For your facilitation, the new introduction or the introduction that we have done this year is to introduce benchmarks. Most of these benchmarks will be relevant for trend questions. So please go through the benchmarks that the company has provided and read the trend or the performance of the company on that indicator basis the benchmark that the company has provided. There can be situations where the company has not provided any benchmarks. And there can be various reasons to it. One is that company doesn't have those benchmarks or the company is not aware of those benchmarks. You can then make your assessment basis the pattern that you see in last 5 years and what the company has targeted for the next 5 years. As I said, for each aspect, assessor view is mandatory. The word limit for an assessor view is 750 words. You can make your assessor's view the way you want to. You can write paragraphs or you can bullet it out. It's entirely dependent on in which structure you're comfortable. Please use the additional information provided by the applicant. The last page of your assessment will be review and submit. This page is mainly to facilitate your assessment and to give you an idea how much assessment is remaining in terms of numbers. So if there is any part of the application document where there are pending validations or where there are pending assessor's view, this review and submit page can be used to see where exactly the pending work is. By clicking on the pending validations, it will give you a list of questions against which the pending validations are still there. Assessor view basically gives you a yes or no. So in case if there is no assessor view given for an aspect, the assessor view will appear as no. It is important that all assessor's view against each aspect are turned into yes. Only then you will be allowed to submit your assessment. As you can see on the screen, there is no submit button appearing. The submit button will only appear when all the pending validations have become zero and all the assessor's views have become yes. few quick points for your reference. Every assessor is required to do the assessment. In case you have registered and at any point you think that you cannot take forward the assessment, please keep the awards team informed. If you continue to remain associated for assessment, you will be mandatorily required to complete your individual assessment and then be part of the consensus meeting and be part of the site visits. A team will not be allowed to proceed with the consensus meetings until and unless every team member in the team have submitted their individual assessment. Team lead will have the right to make the changes basis the consensus meetings that you're going to do, both at the desk assessment and site assessment. A corporate excellence application site assessment usually takes 4 to 5 days. This is including the travel days. It will also depend on the location which you're visiting and the location from where you're making your travel. If it's an interior location, their site visit may also last for 6 days. A domain excellence site visit can take 3 to 4 days. Again, the location will also decide how many number of days a domain excellence application is taking. Usually in a corporate excellence application, we have 4 to 5 assessors, and in a domain excellence application, we have 3 to 4 assessors, but a minimum of 3 assessor team is required to conduct the assessment. It is mandatory that all the site assessment consensus is completed while the team is on site. However, if due to any technical problem, the team is unable to submit their consensus, they are required to have their consensus meeting and close the consensus result offline. And the team lead will then be given 2 to 3 days to submit that assessment online through the web tool. The assessment schedule is for your reference. We looked at this when I was taking you through the award cycle, but just to again give you more details. After we have done this webinar, we will start with the desk assessment, and before we start with the desk assessment, we will register all the new assessors on the tool. In case if there is any change in your email ID, please keep us informed in next 1 or 2 days where you want to receive the intimation and the communication regarding the assessment. We will make the relevant changes. This is applicable to both old and new assessors. From June end till July end will be the time when you will be given to do your desk assessment, both individual as well as consensus desk assessment. The jury meeting will take place in August mid, and basis that the companies which are qualifying for site assessment will be communicated to you as part of your team by end of August. Your availability for site assessment will be taken for you from you in advance. So we request that while you're doing your desk assessment, also discuss within your team which are those dates or mutually convenient date slots when the team can conduct the site assessment between September and October. Just before the end of desk assessment, we will get in touch with you to take your site visit dates. We will keep them ready. So in case if your applications are qualifying for site assessment, whichever is qualifying, we will communicate those dates to the companies. This will save our time as well also give companies enough time to prepare themselves for site assessment. We request that when you're deciding on the date slots, please identify 2 to 3 date slots for the site visit. Again, from September to October, site visits will be conducted, and in November, basis your completion and submission, the third jury meeting will take place to decide the winners. The result of assessor recognition survey will also be announced in end of December. So after each team has completed their site assessment, they will be given access to an online survey where they will have to rate their peer assessors on the indicators which are part of the survey. Survey also takes place with the applicant which the assessors visit. So a similar survey form will be sent to the applicant who the assessors have visited, and their feedback will also be taken. Basis this survey, the winners of assessor recognition will be decided, and the winners will be communicated of their recognition in advance so that they can make their travel arrangements for the ceremony accordingly. The award ceremony will take place on 12th of December, and all of you are invited to attend the ceremony on 12th of December. It will take place at in Delhi at Le Meridien. Closer to the ceremony, we will communicate to you the timings and the schedule of the ceremony. But as we have mentioned during the training program as well, all of you are invited to attend the ceremony, and hence please block this date to be here. So this is all from my side. I will now open the question and answer panel. And in case if you have not typed in your question, you can type in your question now. And I'll take each and every question one by one so that I'm able to answer most of the question. In case if there are any further questions, or if there is any question which I'm unable to answer during this webinar, please get in touch with me separately, or send in your questions to Sustainability Awards team and we will take care of them. So the question is on how are we making the entire program carbon neutral. As I said, the entire awards is aspiring to become carbon neutral. There are certain, so if you look at the awards as a whole, there are various places at which there are emissions. So for example, when we start the award cycle, we conduct the first jury meeting. So the travel of our jury members will be taken in consideration. While running the awards day in and day out, what are the emissions that we are making, that will be taken in consideration. The water consumption, the paper consumption, all of that will be taken in consideration. The assessors training that we did this year, both in Delhi and Bombay, will be taken in consideration in terms of faculty travel, as well as the participants who travel from various locations to attend the assessor training. Then later during the year, we will take in consideration the site assessment travel that the assessors are going to do and the emissions, resultant emissions because of these site visit travels. Similarly, during the award ceremony, whatever impacts, environmental impacts that the award is making, that will be taken in consideration. The relevant emissions will be calculated. And most likely, we are going to offset the emissions. But I cannot comment on that for sure right now, that what will be the strategy in order to offset the emissions that are going to be calculated. That will be decided once we have the final numbers. Sure, we'll take that feedback. The conference call facilities, we will try and improve them. We will see if there can be any other way through which we can facilitate the conference calls. Also here, I would like to emphasize that if you're in a city where most of your assessor belong to the same place, and CII can facilitate in providing you their office facility to conduct the consensus meetings. So in case if you want to utilize any of the CII offices and the conference room, please keep us informed in advance so that we can look for those facilities and can make them available to you. Why the regulation list is different for environment and biodiversity, I'll suggest that you go and look at the biodiversity regulation list. In future, we can make a common list for environment and biodiversity. But for this year, we have separated the two. There can be certain overlaps in terms of same regulation showing under environment and biodiversity. All the companies have to do is to just mark it twice, and the applicants, assessors will have to just see whether the relevant regulation has been marked or not. But yes, in next year onwards, we are going to have a common list of regulation for both environment and biodiversity. So there is a question if there is a separate domain excellence application on product responsibility. No, there is no separate domain excellence application. Product responsibility is part of corporate excellence application and part of environment management application. Product responsibility looks at, there are certain indicators which look at the environment as well as the health and safety and the social part of product responsibility also. And those changes have been done this year in the product responsibility questions. In case if you need any sector specific information and you cannot find it through the management description that the applicant has submitted, or you cannot, you're not able to build it through your team discussions or through looking at some of the commonly available sites, you can get in touch with the awards team and we will try and give you certain documents which can help you build on sector specific information. CII does not provide the benchmarks because CII doesn't have the sector-specific benchmarks, and that is why this year award application is asking the applicants to provide the benchmark, because benchmarks are usually used by the applicants in various places, especially when they are doing their competitor analysis. So they have most of the benchmarks available with them. So applicants can very easily provide these sector benchmark, their specific benchmarks that they use. And the same will be used by assessors to draw conclusions and references against which they can use these benchmarks for the indicators. There is no change in the placement of additional information, because additional information is mainly meant for the aspect and not specifically for questions. If you want to make it specifically for questions, you can give a question reference in the additional information box. Editing of company answers can only be done by the team lead after the consensus with the team. But first of all, the editing of company answers is available only during site assessment. It is not available during desk assessment. Second, when the team has decided on making any changes, this is part of consensus. So until and unless every member of the team is agreeing to make that change, the team lead is not allowed to make any change to the answers given by the company. And hence, it is part of the consensus and can be done during site assessment consensus by the team lead. So regarding the carbon neutral thing, as I had mentioned, I've already mentioned the activities that we are going to take in consideration, which I briefly mentioned, the trainings, the assessment, jury meetings, etc. And we are going to buy the carbon offsets to offset the GHG emissions, which are going to get calculated through the activities that I have mentioned. In case if you want to change your email ID and you want to direct all the communication to another email ID, then please keep the awards team informed. Please write to sustainabilityawards@cii.in. Provide your new email ID on which you want the communication to be directed, and we will make the changes from the back end. Information gaps are the first list of reference points which are used for site visit for clarity. So in case if the company has marked in their questionnaire answers as information gaps, the report will automatically identify those questions and information gaps, and you will see an icon of IG appearing against those questions. So as the team, you can directly ask some of these identified questions which are marked as information gaps from the company in the first place itself, and give company some time to give you information against these information gaps. Here again, we will emphasize that you shouldn't push the applicant to provide information. In case if the applicant has that information, they will provide you in the first place itself. So there is another question on carbon neutral, which is asking that carbon neutral starts from traveling location to site assessment and can we utilize common transport? We will say that yes, you can go ahead and utilize common transport, but all using a common transport will definitely reduce some of the emissions. But again, the common transport will also be taken in consideration when we are calculating the emissions for that particular team. So if you are from the same city and if you're taking the flights to your respective sites, you can opt to take the same flight, and mostly this is done when the awards team is facilitating the site visit schedule. So it's not that this year we are going to do, but year on year basis when we facilitate the site visits, we ensure that when people are traveling from same location, they take the same flight. If they are residing close by, they can also decide to take a common transport and come to the airport or the railway station. The assessors will get the applications and the team assignment will happen in next few days. So by mid of June, you will receive an intimation on your team composition as well as the applications that are assigned to you. So there is a question on why supply chain domain has been missed this year. That is a conscious decision that was taken by the jury this year to not have supply chain domain as one of the categories under domain excellence. The reason was, so we have not removed supply chain altogether. We have just parked it aside for this year and for next 1 or 2 years because the response on supply chain has been not so good in terms of the number of companies applying for supply chain as well as the quality of applications that we are receiving. And this is a feedback that we have received from applicants only, where they have very openly mentioned to us that at this stage, they are at a stage where they are looking at their own operations and trying to embed sustainability in their own operations, and supply chain is something that is still not in their radar. So it will still take some more years for them to start looking at their supply chain. Also, if you remember, when we look at supply chain from the sustainability performance assessment, we are not just looking at the tier one suppliers. We are expecting companies to look at tier one and tier two and critical suppliers and all of it. And it's not just the supplier side, but also the other side of the value chain, like the dealers and the retailers and the basically the parties on the other side of the chain. So that is where the companies have mentioned to us that they are not looking at this entire supply chain currently, and it is difficult for them to give us the quality answers because the integration is not happening so much. So that is why the jury consciously decided to park it aside for next couple of years, and then we can bring it back after a gap of few years. There is a little clarity which is required regarding the review on assessor viewpoints, as there is little ambiguity on scoring. So I'm not sure why the scoring is becoming you're looking at scoring being ambiguous. The reason is that we provide guidance on the scoring in as part of the guidance document. As assessors, you may not be required to do the scoring because that is automatically taken care by the tool basis the assessment that you have done. Now, just to give you a small example, the objective questions are scored basis the answer option that the applicant has chosen. So out of the 4 answer options, if the applicant has chosen 1, basis the answer option, there is already a score allocated to each of the answer option. Whichever answer the applicant has chosen, the relevant score for that answer option will be taken in consideration by the tool. Second, all the descriptive questions where the assessors are required to do the assessment in terms of choosing the validations, there is a score which is allocated against each validation. This is the choice that the assessor is making on the validation selection. The score is given to that particular question. Now, each question in the questionnaire is marked out of 100. So every question that either the company chooses to answer or the assessor validated through their validation will get scored out of 100. Once the entire scoring is done for each and every question, you may already know that each question is also mapped with an attribute. So every question in the questionnaire has an attribute allocated to it. So for example, when we look at questions like policy, or if the company has human rights policy in place, these are mostly leadership related questions. We already know that there are weights allocated to each and every attribute, which we had discussed during the training program. Basis the attribute which is mapped to the question, the weight is allocated to that particular question. So for example, if the mapped question is identified as a leadership question and the leadership has a weight of 20, the score of that particular question will get weighted by the leadership weight, and so on and so forth. After that, the score of the entire aspect will be brought down on the scale of 100. So for example, if there are 10 questions in an aspect, the total score which the company can get will be 1000. And if the actual score that the company has got basis the answer options that they have chosen, it is say 700, then 700 out of 1000 will be brought down on the scale of 100, and then that will be weighted as per the aspect weight that is allocated. Each aspect has a different weight. In corporate excellence, we saw that there are 14 aspects on which the scoring takes place. Every aspect has a different weight. Now, weights here are also dependent on which are the leading aspects and which are the smaller aspects. Some of the leading aspects, as you may know, are corporate governance, say for example, which defines how the governance structure is made in order to drive the organization towards being a sustainable business. Similarly, aspects like environment performance or corporate social responsibility, these are also leading aspects. So the relative weights for these aspects are a little higher than the other aspects which are smaller, say for example human rights or business ethics. Now, basis the score that the company has got on that aspect, and once it has been brought down on the scale of 100, that gets weighted by that aspect weight, and then depending on this cumulative scores across each aspect, the final score of the company is calculated. So the score that is given to the company or that is arrived for a company is out of 100. A guidance that I have mentioned to you just now is also mentioned as part of your guidance document in the last section. So if at all, anytime as assessors, you want to know how the scoring is taking place, you can always refer to the last section of the guidance document, which not only mentions the scoring methodology that the tool is equipped to do, but also the weights that are defined across different aspects as well as across the 7 attributes. The only point to remember is that when you are marking an aspect, when you are writing your assessor's view should be aligned with the selection that you have made in the validations or any changes to the answers that you have done for the applicant during site assessment. Because your assessor views are flowing from what the company has submitted as answers as well as what selection you're marking as validation. So there shouldn't ideally be a mismatch between what you're writing in an assessor's view and with what the tool is calculating at the back end. So there is a request which is saying that we should avoid allocating repeat applicants to old assessors. We try and avoid that, except for so at times we have to bring in an old assessor for repeat applicant, but that is done only for 1 year. The reason is that for a repeat applicant, it's important for the team to understand how the performance of the company was last year, and the kind of insights that an old assessor can bring to the team can be much better, and that is why in 1 year an old assessor is given. However, if the company has been applying for more than 1 year, then we don't put the same assessor again and again for a repeat applicant. With respect to what you need to do and what you don't need to do for site assessment, we will give you a guidance note before the site assessment to prepare you to conduct the site assessment. There will be general guidelines. So just the way you have instructions page on the web tool to facilitate you on the online assessment, we will be providing you with a ready list of guidance points for the site assessment, but that will come to you immediately before the site assessment. As I said, there is no separate application for product responsibility. Product responsibility is part of corporate excellence application and of environment management application. In case if you are in a situation where you find that what the company has answered in their application, there is a mismatch when you go on the site visit, you are not required to change the descriptive answer of the company. Okay, what you have to do, that basis the evidence that you have gathered during the site, you can make the changes to the validations that you have selected in the descriptive questions. So only by choosing the validation, the score of the company can be changed. For answers to be changed given by the company are mainly meant for objective questions. So, because if there is a mismatch in any of the answers given by the company on the objective questions, you should ideally go and change the answers there, because that is going to affect the scoring directly. And for the descriptive questions, don't change the descriptive answers written by the company, but make the change in the validations basis what you found on the site. That will then affect the scoring. In case if the applicant has more than one site to be visited, yes, the travel time can increase. The site visit usually happens only for one site, but if there are multiple businesses that the company has applied for, and for that, there are more than one sites to be visited, say for example two sites to be visited, then of course the site visit time can increase by few days, so for example by 2-3 days more. So the benchmarks that the company are going to provide, you don't need to validate that. Benchmark information is only for your reference. They are not to be scored. None of the benchmark is required to be scored. It is not meant for validation. They are only being asked from the applicant to help you assess the indicators on which the benchmarks are required. So benchmark information should only be used as a reference point by the assessors against the indicators which are around which the benchmark is asked. The company's responses during site visit need to be edited in case of mismatch. So in case if you find more evidence of the information provided by the company, and if you don't change the response, their assessment and their result will not improve. That is why it is important that assessors make a change to the company response during site assessment to do a fair assessment. As I said, for subjective questions, you have to read the description provided by the company, and basis the description, there will be a list of validation which will be provided. The list of validation will differ for each descriptive question. Now, each of these validations, you can make a selection basis what the company has responded during task assessment. On site, if you are in a situation where you find more information or less information, instead of changing the answer written by the company on descriptive question, you can make the change to the validation selection that you have made in the desk assessment. Compliance to regulation is not scored, because regulations for a company will differ for each company depending on the nature of business that they belong to. The scoring is not meant to be done for compliance to regulation, because compliance to regulation is mainly meant for looking at a laundry list of regulations. The related question which is scored in compliance to regulation is part of each and every aspect, where we are looking at how the organization is dealing with non-compliances. That is one. Second is, what process that the organization has in place to look at non-compliances. So this will give assessors a fair idea on two things. One is that does the company has a full-fledged streamlined process to identify non-compliance? Second, the kind of non-compliances that the company has received during the reporting period. So these questions are scored, and this is where the scoring should happening. Whereas the compliance regulation is only a laundry list of regulations, so scoring those questions will really not make a fair assessment to the company. If there is any information that you need from the applicant during site assessment, please go ahead and ask for it. But please make sure that the information that you're asking is relevant to the questionnaire that you're referring to. Don't ask evidence or information which is out of context or beyond the boundary of the awards questionnaire, because the company can question your question. They can ask you that why do you need this information, and the assessment process doesn't allow the assessors to go beyond the boundary of the awards questionnaire. However, any evidence, any information, any document that you need as part of the assessment that you're doing and within the boundary of the awards questionnaire, please go ahead and ask it. Please make sure that whatever you are asking from the company during site assessment is in consensus with all the team members. So individually, you shouldn't go and ask the company, but as part of the team, and when the entire team has agreed on asking some of these documents or questions, then you put forward these requests to the company. During desk assessment, the process of asking the questions from the company is not allowed. It's only during site assessment that you can ask the company. Abhishek, when you are asking, when the assessors make a change to the objective question and when the final submission happens, yes. And so the point here is that if I refer back you to the reports that get generated from the tool, what you are going to change as a team in the site assessment interface will get captured in the site assessment report, whereas what gets captured in the desk assessment report will be what the company has answered. Similarly, what gets captured in the preliminary report is what the company has answered. So any change that the assessor is making to the applicant's response will only get captured in the site assessment report. So this feature is definitely available in the system and to the assessors also. So if at all they want to refer in future that what are the changes they made versus what was reported by the company, they can compare the desk assessment and the site assessment report. In case if you are having issues with your companies to release you from site assessment, our suggestion is that please give them an advance notice that you will be requiring leaves. In case if you need our facilitation, if you want us to write to your employer to release you and request them, we can facilitate that as well. You can connect with us, you can send in your request, you can speak with us, and we can issue the letters, and you can let us know to whom the letter can be addressed so that we can at least facilitate that part of work and if that can help you in getting leaves from the company. Thanks to all of you. We will be sharing the recorded version of this webinar and as well as the presentation. So you can refer to it and the presentation in future. All the best for the assessments. And in case any time during assessment, if you face any issues or any problems, you can get in touch with the awards team. Thanks a lot and have a good day.